Hello and welcome to the special show. I'm Poonam Sharma. COVID-19, the disruptor. One of the sectors which has taken the proverbial bull by the horns is education. To talk more about this sector, how it's reinventing itself, the challenges it's facing, we have two very special guests with us from Global Indian International School, co-founder and chairman, Mr. Atul Timurnikar, and deputy COO, Mr. Rajiv Katyal. Atul, Rajiv, welcome to this special show. Thank you so much for being here. The new way of meeting, interacting, and interviewing people, the new normal, I would say.
Yeah, pleasure to be here.
Yes, good morning. Yes, it's very, I would say it is a new normal for many students, but it has been pretty much normal for us. So this is, it's a great beginning to a new chapter.
Atul, we know that Global Indian International School has put in all the efforts, the right technology and all the support in place in all your campuses to make sure that the learning journey of the students continue and it's not disrupted. To begin with, take me through this journey that you've had. How did you introduce this new way of educating and learning in the GIS ecosystem? Give me an idea of the scale that you had and also the community adoption. How did the parents and students take this up?
Global Schools Foundation has always been thinking 8 to 10 years ahead of time. And this led to the idea of a first smart campus, which has been implemented at most of our campuses. This further led to our education continuity plan, which was built on prior experiences of SARS in 2003. And now that has proven itself in the COVID-19. With the advent of the mobile and 4G systems and the general digital evolution, GSF realized that bringing the digital change to the education sector would revolutionize the very way in which teaching was imparted. It would change the way classrooms would function, and very importantly, it would embrace the new age thinking of the young students and teachers. With an early grasp of the trend, GSF initiated a task force of in-house academic experts and technology experts to identify the exclusive digital experience which imparted the highest learning outcome. In the process, GIS worked with some of the world's leading companies, including Apple, IBM, and I personally spoke to Cisco's CEO, Mr. John Chambers, and several others to create that unique GIS digital learning experience. We have used Zoom for the past 5 years in limited learning activities. And now, you see, today it has become a household name. We have decided to transform every single of our GIS campus as a school of the future. And this is not just about deploying technology or Wi-Fi or smart boards in the classroom, but it's about how much positive, tangible improvements we are providing in every child's learning journey so that every GIS student will achieve to the best of their learning potential. So every aspect of the learning journey has been curated to deliver these outcomes. In the early 2000s, GIS focused its automation on all its workflows and processes to free up the teachers from the redundant roles of administration and to allow them to spend more time in their classrooms and with their students. During the past decade, GIS has focused on education best practices and benchmarking to global standards and enhancing the digital experience to benefit the students and the teachers. But frankly, all this was not in anticipation of any specific natural disasters, but our farsightedness has been beneficial to the students and parent community in the long run.
So Atul, you gave us a sense of how prepared you were much before COVID-19, and having a smart campus in Singapore definitely helped. But tell me, at what stage did you recognize COVID-19 as a business and education challenge?
So when the COVID-19 news broke around 30th of January, our teams, completely unaware of the snowballing effect that was to take place, the entire GSF team of more than 150 members of the GIS and OWIS executive teams were parked in Bali, Indonesia, and discussing various aspects of School of the Future and planning for what was needed to be executed in the next 2 years. On 27th of February, the Japanese government was the first in Asia to close down all the schools. That's when GIS schools in Japan triggered our business continuity plans, and we at GSF took a major decision to roll out the GIS virtual classrooms at all our GIS campuses. At this stage, we knew we were fully prepared to go virtual, process-wise, systems-wise, and technology-wise. But we had to put in extra effort to ensure maximum security was used in these GIS virtual classrooms so that our students had the safest experience.
So Adil, how did it help the students, this digital journey that you're talking about? Take us through, you know, how the adoption happened with them and how much work went into that.
Like I said, we had already embraced new technology in education. It was done for the sake of students who deserve good education, good schooling, modern infrastructure to thrive in the new world. The GIS Virtual Classrooms Initiative is an excellent testimony to GIS's commitment to bringing world-class education programs to our students. It worked for us because during the early days of COVID, no sooner than a challenge rose like the social distancing and where the schools were still operational like in Singapore, we split our students into two groups with half of the students in the class and the remaining half joining the virtual classrooms from their homes. You would be pleased to know that despite COVID, GIS is one of the very few schools in Asia and Middle East which is offering 120 hours a month of live virtual teaching to all the students, thereby ensuring GIS students derive maximum learning benefit during this COVID period. This is particularly significant when most schools across Asia and Middle East have tremendously scaled down their teaching periods to just over 2 to 5 hours a week. And some have mostly resorted to asking students to view the recorded lectures or educational videos. In addition to some asking their students to spend most of the time during the week in a non-interactive basis by submitting school assignments on school portals. GIS teachers at our campuses have quickly adjusted to the new normal.
So Adil, you spoke about virtual classrooms. I personally feel that, you know, there is no substitute to a real classroom, the interaction that the students have with their classmates, the teacher and everything. But yes, this is the new normal and we all have to accept. Can you give us a sense of something else other than the virtual classrooms that GIS has introduced that has really helped students to kind of feel maybe very normal and have a sense of a real being in a real school at a real time?
In the early weeks, we used our radio station facilities, which was originally meant to impart RJing skills to the students, to record webinars and podcasts on virtual classrooms. Our TV station too was roped in to provide video content to the students and the parents on virtual classrooms. You know, nowadays WhatsApp is very heavily used by parents, so a WhatsApp-based help desk was also initiated for all our students and parents to resolve their virtual classroom connection issues and access issues. Our student community is very smart. They adopted faster than ever. The parents were also very receptive and enthusiastic about not having to miss important lessons for their children. So they participated with equal zeal. Teachers helped each other, and our IT department and help desk staff ensured that help was available at all times, sometimes even 24/7, to ensure all the staff and all the teachers are able to access virtual classrooms in an efficient manner. Within 2 weeks, we were up and running, and barring some initial hiccups, we were able to run the system smoothly. Kudos to our team who took it upon themselves to explain each and every aspect to the parents and the students about the functioning of the virtual classroom system, its workings, etc. So we were at it 24/7, including weekends, till the system smoothened out. Now, we have no issues and no problems. In fact, all our virtual classrooms work better and it is far safer than some of the free softwares available in the market.
Adil, you're speaking about the community adopting it very quickly and everybody coming on board. I think it'll be great to also hear from some parents on the change and how did their children take to distance learning. We spoke to some of the parents from Global Indian International Schools only a little earlier. Let's hear what they have to say.
Good day. My name is Nikesh Patel. I am a research professional and my son is studying in GIS grade 1. GIS taking care of their pupil for current learning through virtual classes, and their staff is really trained. Teachers are really engaging students via various videos, painting, crafting and moral stories and etc. And those are really engaging them. They are feeling like they are virtually present in the class. Even like we need to extend this for the couple of months due to this challenging situation, I think studies will not be compromised. It will be up to the utmost quality. And this is a opportunity for our kids to learn in the virtual environment, because this is the future. So I wish this could even continue after schools are physically opened. I really thank you, all the GIS staff, all the teachers, and good luck them for the future.
Myself, Aruna Girish, and my daughter, Prapti Girish, studied in 7 CBSE, GIS Smart Campus, Singapore. After being hit with a global pandemic COVID-19, I'm glad to see that GIS has started reaping its being smartness by switching over to the virtual learning. This has led to the no disruptions in skill learning. Coming to the Prapti has a seamless experience in switching over to the virtual class. She is very prompt, punctual, and she has sharpened her digital skills also. This wouldn't have been possible without the good cooperation and support by the teachers and the IT department. I truly appreciate all the teachers' support, their patience, their energy level. Hats off to them. Now coming to the post-COVID-19 situation. When the school reopens, we parents would strongly recommend the school to continue with the virtual learning facilities with the proper guidelines to the board. This will help the school to address with the situation or the scenarios like learning from home, during emergencies, or the sickness. Let's stay home, stay safe. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Yushin Jin. My son Louis Jin is studying in grade 7 with Global Indian International School, Abu Dhabi. I personally believe that adaptation is the key to success in life. And the results are evident if there is consistency. The virtual classes, engineered and executed under the leadership of our respected principal, Dr. Hina Raj, is a clear example. Despite this current situation, the tireless team of professional GIIS teachers has done a really, really great job by bringing parents and students together under one common platform just with the click of a button. Excellent PPT, audio clarity, time management, and Q&A sessions are very interactive and commendable. There is transparency in every information provided, and there are also webinars for parents that has assured a sense of security. Louis looks forward to every session with much enthusiasm. The webinars have also enhanced his computer skills. The well-structured modules are very interactive and has made education more fun. My son Louis is in the right path, paving his future with Global Indian International School. Thank you.
Rajiv, like Atul mentioned, at Global Indian International School, you guys preempted, were prepared with your distance learning programs and your virtual classrooms. And that's why the learning journey has continued without any disruption. But I'm sure there have been many challenges that you have faced during these last couple of weeks and continue to face. Take us through these challenges that have come from the students, parents, and even your teaching community, because it does take a long time for everyone to come on the same page in times like these, isn't it?
See, being proactive was actually handling part of the challenge, because you were already a digital campus with smart boards, with iPads, with Wi-Fi connectivity, and you know, students and teachers using all of it together. It was sort of ready for the virtual world. However, when it came to the fact that the children were now going to learn from home and we were going to teach from a distance, the whole classroom was shifting to a virtual scenario, which nobody was used to, neither the parents, nor the students, nor the teachers. So we had to overcome these challenges. The best part is none of these challenges remain right now. So for example, if you look at the parents, for them, the child being at home was a challenge. So providing for the child an ambience of learning, a quiet corner where there's no disturbance, making sure the technology requires or she requires it at place was one of the things which the parent was facing as a challenge, and they had to surmount, and they were able to do so. Secondly, parents had a lot of questions about these virtual classrooms. We were not totally convinced about these virtual classrooms. So we had to talk to the parents, and our principals and our academic leads then did webinars We did podcasts. We did question answer sessions. We did FAQs on the website. And we talked to the parents and answered all their concerns and queries in a particular way till the parents were convinced that the child and the school both were ready to impart virtual education. That is one part. When it comes to the children, frankly speaking, the children did not require or face any difficulty because children are very digitally savvy by nature. So they took to it like a fish to water, and I think quite enjoyed the virtual learning experience because they're the comfort of the home, yet they were in touch with their teacher. So they took to all the paraphernalia very easily. When it came to teachers, yes, initially it was a challenge because the teachers are used to being in a physical classroom where they control the students and they interact with them physically. Now they're doing so on a virtual medium. But our teachers have been doing that in many ways across campuses, but it was a new experience. So the teachers had to get used to a new technology called the Zoom webinar. They had to learn how to use it and its various features, and they were trained by us in doing so effectively. Most importantly, when they started teaching, there were different sections of students. For example, the pre-primary students, they are very, very small. Their attention span is very, very small. So there, the teachers had to teach less and make them interact more, engage them more. And they took a lot of parent support in keeping the child engaged in the virtual classroom. When it came to the primary classrooms, a slightly older set, there it was 50-50. 50% of time they were teaching, 50% of time they were getting children in activity. Then when it came to secondary students, so from class 6 all the way to class 12, there it had to be very serious teaching. There were 6 periods of 1 hour each, which went on and on, and teachers had to be ready with lesson plans for virtual classrooms. They had to use technology like whiteboard applications, which they could download onto their devices and write on those and show it to the children. They had to download videos, they had to make presentations, and the entire teaching methodology had to be embellished with all these things, which the teachers were able to do. And slowly, the parents, students, and teachers all came together and were able to surmount all these challenges. And what Atul mentioned about the fact that we use a help desk technology where if the teachers, the students, or the parents had any challenge, they could send a query on WhatsApp and immediately there was a help desk ready to help them. So all this together came around so beautifully. At this point of time, I think everybody is quite enjoying it and there's not much challenge left in it.
But Rajiv, tell me, there is a side effect to this, right? Increased screen time for children. It's also something that you guys thought about when you were designing these programs that, you know, children are going to be spending 5 or 6 hours in front of their screens other than them spending more screen time after the school finishes because they are home most of the time. That's going to be something that the parents have to deal with.
Yeah, that's a concern because you see, screen time actually makes the child sort of face the screen again and again. It can have an impact on the eyes. And also, you know, mentally it can be quite exhausting. So the parents are very concerned about it. So what we did was we did a number of things. For example, the very young children, it was more of the teacher addressing them and then using the parent who's also working from home to engage them in certain activities, then coming back to the screen. So the screen time was intermittent with the activity time. As the children became older and they were taking the classes, that point of time, there was just more screen time. At the same time, they were being given assignments on tools like Google Classroom to do the assignments, solve the questions. So they could go off screen during that time period and they could do the exercise then come back to the teacher. So it was not just 6 hours or 5 hours or 3 hours of continuous screen time. It was intermittent screen time with assignments being given, with the teacher being present right through. So that was like an actual classroom running, but the exposure to the screen of the eyes was reduced. Secondly, for the very young children, the screen time was not more than 2 hours. I mean, the virtual class was not more than 2 to 3 hours. And it went up to 5 to 6 hours maximum for the older children. And as I said, the intermittent use of screen and assignments made it much easier and less of a strain for both the students and the teachers.
A change of this magnitude is going to leave a high residual impact. Some experiences and habits are likely to remain. They're not going to change. What will post-COVID-19 GIS look like? Have you thought about that? Is it something that you have already started working towards, Rajiv?
Well, I don't think anybody has right envisaged the post-COVID-19 world. I mean, we have seen dolphins in the Italian Sea. We've seen peacocks on the roads of India. All those kinds of things are happening. I think the post-COVID-19 world is a bit right now difficult to interpret. What can one definitely say is that the virtual method of teaching learning has now going to has come to stay. It will remain like this for quite some time. So post-COVID-19, I feel there will be a gradual transition from a total virtual world to a total physical world. In between, there will be an intermittent period where there will be partly physical and partly virtual. So part of the students may come to the classroom and keep a physical safe distance, and part of them stay at home and they can keep alternating like that. So part of the teaching will still remain virtual. At the same time, technologies like virtual classroom, learning management systems have exhibited their power during the COVID world, that they can be very, very effective teaching tools, because teachers can get very creative in terms of creating videos, presentations, new methods of interaction, new methods of collaborative learning. So I feel once post-COVID-19, the entire physical act of being in a class resumes, this virtual technology will be used in after-school learning in terms of reinforcing student learning, giving them assignments, doing remedial teaching, addressing student concerns one-to-one. So a lot of things will happen. And moreover, we'll also learn how to use to extracurricular activities using the virtual classroom. That's also very important. A third thing is this whole virtual world has made the whole world virtually borderless. So now we can see that GIS, with its 21 schools all over the world, has become a global digital campus, which means the best teachers in any part of the world can teach students in any other part of the world. There's a very good teacher in maths in Abu Dhabi. He can teach students in Singapore. There's a very good English teacher in Singapore. He can teach students in India. A very good physics teacher in India can teach students in Tokyo. So this virtual world opens a lot of boundaries in terms of how collaborative learning can make learning even more effective. To me, virtual learning and physical learning together will make for far more powerful learning in the post-COVID-19 world.
And my last question is to both you, Rajiv, and to Atul as well. What has GIS done differently? What are the best practices of GIS that you can share with us and that could be a learning for other educational institutions?
Yeah, okay. So I think, Poonam, being proactive was what GIS did differently. We were already a digital school, so all the paraphernalia, the equipment was there, the iPads were there, the smart screens were there, the Wi-Fi connectivity was there, the face recognition systems were there. As a result of which, the students and teachers are very used to technology. So transitioning to a virtual classroom world was very, very easy for GIS, not only in Singapore, but all over the world. That was one. Two, what we did differently was that because we are a globally connected chain of schools, you know, school teachers could talk to each other, students could talk to each other, school administration could talk to each other. And there was a lot of learning which happened between all of us, as a result of which there was better coordination and faster right up the learning curve. Thirdly, when it comes to things like ordering of books, uniforms, you know, we were ready with an online system to make sure the parents were able to pay online, order online, and then receive books and uniforms, you know, at their own convenience. So the physical act of doing all these administrative things with the school also went away. Most importantly, I think what has changed is different in our case was that unlike many other schools in which it was more of some interaction on the virtual screen and then children being given assignments to do, we, through our technology, brought the live school completely into the living room of the child. We ran the virtual school in a way any school would run in normal circumstances in a physical way. And that made the learning very, very real for the child. I think getting the school from a physical to a virtual space in its entirety almost was a very big difference which GIS made to virtual learning.
Atul?
Your question is as innocent as it sounds, and it's more likely to be a subject matter for PhD for thousands of universities across the world. As of March 13th, the OECD estimated that over 421 million children were affected due to the school closures. And over a billion students worldwide were unable to go to their schools and colleges. These changes have certainly caused a degree of inconvenience, But education has been nudged and pushed to a change in a rapid and faster pace that could lead to surprising educational innovations. The post-COVID future, according to me, is not bleak, but it's very encouraging. We need to rethink on how we educate our future generations. But we will try to explain in a very simple way. Firstly, we've always believed in having a rapid response to embracing the new, which will help us communicate with our students in a better way, particularly when they are away from their classrooms and lecture theatres. One such example is of blended learning, which we have been using for the past few years. It's a combination of asynchronous and synchronous platforms like the EdTech solutions and the virtual platforms. And these bring huge benefits to the GIS students' community. Such digital tools with the right balance of face-to-face and virtual components will complement the learning in a very positive way. We have seen this acceptance in the past 2 months from our parent community who have praised us on our efforts to bring the school to their homes and ensure continuity of their children's education. In future, blended learning will be to schools what libraries are to the knowledge, a repository of progress. Secondly, with 5G technology becoming more prevalent in countries such as US, Japan, and China, we will see learners and solution providers truly embracing the learning anywhere, anytime concept of the digital education in a range of formats. Traditional classroom learning will be complemented with new modalities, from live broadcast to educational influencers to virtual reality experiences. All this will be implemented in a safe environment for students, which is the topmost agenda for GSF. We have stringent rules in place on who has access to students during the school hours, and we will continue to remain alert to the dynamically changing security environment to ensure safety of all our students. However, we need to be mindful that we are dealing with Generation Alpha, children of the millennials or Generation Z. For these parents, terms like FOBA, fear of being alone, or FOMO, fear of missing out, are real threats to their success. And they use technology to express their expectation of instant communication and feedback. Think of Facebook Messenger or WhatsApp. Education has to become part of their social life. Their success will mean solutions to the world problems like climate change and mental health issues. While Generation Alpha is at this point probably oblivious to the impact of global pandemic on their education, it is up to us to nurture them so that the impact would be minimized. We can do this through finding delicate balance between effective use of remote or online learning and face-to-face learning, and teaching them the importance of human need for meaningful social interaction. That's when a healthy new generation will lead the world, and there remains the biggest challenge. But with the right amount of intelligent quotient and the emotional quotient, we'll be able to achieve it.
Exactly. I would totally agree with that, because this is not a productivity contest right now in the current times. And what is most important is that whatever the environment the child is in, he should be happy and his learning journey should continue. And I think at Global Indian International School, you have done that exceptionally well. Atul Rajiv, thank you so much for your time. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.